I'm not here for popularity context. The most important issue right now is what the coalition government has set to do under the visionary leadership of the Honourable Prime Minister.
And they see the ministers going off on overseas trips.
We, as a government, we have to be mindful that it is prudent, that it is not excessive.
Mula and welcome to the Lens at 177. I'm so happy to be seated at the office of our esteemed Deputy Prime Minister and the Minister for Finance, Professor Biman Prasad's office at level 10 here in Suva. In July 4th to July the 12th, the Fiji Times and Tabat conducted a poll after a very long time. And it was done on a random national sample of 1,014 adults aged 18 years and above, and we used a random digital dial computer assisted telephone system. And the questions were, overall, how good is a job is a person doing in the position that they're in? And the five leaders that were, the questions were asked of, included Sitiveni Rambuka, our Prime Minister, and the Deputy Prime Ministers, Bill Ngavoka, Mano Kamikamida, and Professor Prasad. And also the leader of the opposition, Mr. Enia Seruratu. As expected, the Prime Minister received an approval rating of 72%, the overall majority. Mr. Kamikamida received 61%, and Mr. Ngavoka 58%. The opposition leader, Mr. Seruratu, polled 44%. But the biggest surprise was that our National Federation Party leader and the Deputy PM, Professor Biman, came in with a whopping 66%. So, sir, my question to you, are you surprised and how do you feel about the poll result?
Well, Felix, let me thank you for the question and thank you for this program. I'm not here for popularity context. I think the poll is important, but to me, the most important issue right now is what the coalition government has set to do under the visionary leadership of the Honourable Prime Minister, Mr. Sitiveni Rambuka. And I think his leadership is a catalyst for all the ministers and assistant ministers to perform in a way that we are compassionate, that we are on the road, you know, delivering for our people, and that we can bring hope and glory to this country.
Yes.
And we have, as a government, already, you know, provided that freedom. There has been a lot of compassion, you know, from the government when we first started. You know, for example, you know, we allocated $50 million. We gave $200 each to all the school kids, you know, to go to school. So I think for me, that's the most important thing, how the coalition government can deliver to our people.
So, you know, respectfully, we thank you for those words. But I also believe that in the circumstances, you know, given the 15% VAT on certain items, and you know, you've told us that we need to be a bit more prudent and tighten our belts a bit and be a bit more careful, that it's, you know, even the Prime Minister's result at 72% is quite outstanding, and yours at 66%. You know, do you think that that's the confidence of the people in your abilities?
Well, one thing I've been saying, Felix, for the last 5 months, that since we've come into government, we've not only talked about freedom, we've not only talked about consultation and dialogue, we've made good of that. You know, we've got rid of the draconian media decree.
Yes.
We had a very successful national economic summit. We appointed a fiscal review committee. There's been a sense of freedom There's been a sense of exuberance.
Right.
There's been a sense of confidence,
yeah.
Right across the country. And I think, that's reflected in the way we were able to formulate the budget.
Yes.
It was seamless. People felt, part of the process.
Right.
We were open about, what we were planning to do. We laid down the facts, very clearly.
Yes.
In an open, transparent manner.
Right.
We allowed people to criticize us,
yes.
criticize the reports. And so we wanted all that. And I think the people feel good about it.
Yes.
And the overwhelming support that we have received for the budget,
yes.
Despite the fact there are some tough measures.
Yes.
Because the people are intelligent. People are more experienced. People have the wisdom to understand where the country is and what we are doing, and I think that is coming out very clearly in terms of what we hear from the people and the response of the people, and I think that is good for any government.
Right.
But as I said, for me personally, as I said in Parliament, I'm the Prime Minister has not appointed me as Minister of Finance to please him or to please ourselves. We are there to do work,
right.
and that's my mission,
right.
And I want to work very hard. I want to involve as many people as possible in good policy making, because as an economist I understand this very well,
right.
That the government doesn't have all the wisdom,
yes.
all the ideas at all times,
right.
Government's job is to harness those ideas, involve people. There's so much wisdom that resides in the people outside of government,
yes.
In organizations, in the media, in people who have had experience,
yes.
And so getting them together to formulate good policies is very important. And I think coalition government has demonstrated that, and we feel very good about it,
yeah.
that we are talking to the people, we are consulting them, mm-hmm. Even if we know this very well, Felix, that not every decision,
yes.
of the government will be liked by everybody,
yes.
Not every measure in the budget will be liked by everybody. I mean, there are, people will say, okay, why did you do this? This is going to affect my bottom line. But in the overall context, I think even those people, who may be a little bit unhappy about certain measures in the budget,
right.
Understand, and we appreciate their criticisms. We appreciate them, coming to us, having some discussion. And mine's always been an open office.
Yes.
Because I believe that, that is what government should do.
Mm.
And so, putting all that together, it does reflect on how people actually feel.
Yes. You mentioned that the Fijian people are intelligent.
Yeah.
Before the budget, we went out on the streets. My colleague Rodney went out on the streets and spoke to people, ordinary people, working on the city council workers and gardeners. And a number of them mentioned that they were prepared to pay more tax because they understood the situation the country was in.
Exactly. I mean, I'm not surprised with that, because as I said, people told me, they said, we understand where we are, because people understand that we need more money to fix our hospitals,
right.
We need more money to put our machines and consumables in the hospitals,
right.
People know that we need money to fix the drain, fix the road, fix the water supply,
right.
People understand that government needs money to look after our people, education, they also understand that if the government doesn't have the money, we can't help our poor. So if you look at the budget, Felix,
yes.
What we've done, while we are raising more revenue,
yes.
We are putting a lot of money back into health.
Yes.
Health budget has increased by $58 million.
Right.
We've increased agriculture budget.
Right.
We've increased social welfare budget,
right.
By a significant amount.
Yes.
Social pension rates have been increased. So I think what people see now is how this budget has been carefully crafted.
Right.
We the international partners are telling us, you know, this is a good, prudent, fiscally prudent budget.
Yes.
We've reduced the deficit from, you know, average of about 9% over the last few years,
right,
down to 4.8%. So in every measure, we have carefully crafted this budget so that we look after our people, we raise more revenue, we promote economic growth, plus we are able to fiscally, prudently manage our finances.
Right.
So we have put a lid on a lot of the wastages.
Yes.
We put a lid on it. We are looking at how we can get value for money for every dollar that government spends. So these are things that people understand, and you're absolutely right. I mean, people out there,
yes,
are much more intelligent than sometimes people in government think about them. And I understand this. I appreciate that.
Right. Thank you. We'll be right back after a short break.
We were around when the deed was first signed. We were around when the first car engine roared. We were around when the very first was crowned. Through devastations, jubilant celebrations, and the milestones, we will continue to be around to bring you all the stories first.
Welcome back. We're having a really interesting conversation with the Deputy Prime Minister, Minister for Finance, Professor Biman Prasad. We were speaking about the budget, and you know, how you mentioned how well received the budget was by almost all sectors of the country. But your predecessor went on social media and put out a long statement saying the budget will drive us into more debt. And there was a lot of doom saying in his statement.
Mm-hmm.
So do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, this is a man who conveniently forgot. They are still sort of living in the past. He forgot that, you know, he produced some fake budgets in 2018 and 2019, just before the election. And there was a $1 billion hole. In fact, their expenditure was much more than what we had. What we have now in this budget. So I think, you know, as I said, you know, in Hindi, there is a saying called, and I said that in Parliament, you know, "Kisan Billi Khamba Noche," because it's like, you know, people who were expecting. See, the problem with the opposition was that they were expecting this budget because that's what they were saying during the campaign.
Right.
That, oh, the Biman and Rambuka, when they come into government, they'll take away your social welfare,
right,
they'll take away the scholarship, there will be no loans.
Right.
And they continued with that kind of campaign.
Right.
After the government was formed, there was a lot of fear, and some people genuinely, you know, were telling me, you know, older people, they were anxious that new government will take away the social welfare. So when I presented the budget,
yes,
you know, it fell flat on their face, and they were running for cover.
Right.
You know, and so they came up with all these, you know, lies about the fact that, you know, our budget was a big budget, big expenditure, when they themselves, in before the 2018 election, Felix,
yes,
they had projected a revenue. They actually lied to the people,
right,
that, you know, $1 billion hole in that budget.
Right.
The revenue was never there.
Yes.
So they went before into the budget before the election, promising all these things,
right,
promising all this expenditure when the money was not there. So it was a fake budget. And then when we came into 2019,
right,
the economy had contracted because the government had run out of money.
Yes.
And it was negative 1.9%.
Right.
And so when COVID hit us, we went down like nobody's business. That's why we were the fourth largest, we had the fourth largest contraction, out of all the countries in the world. We're the fourth largest. So you had one, two, three, and Fiji was fourth, you know, in terms of the amount of contraction we had in our economy. And if it was not for the support we got from the World Bank in terms of concessional financing, huge budget support from Australia and New Zealand, we would have been in a very, very difficult situation.
Right.
So here is a man who has got this very, very checkered, disastrous record in managing the economy, trying to lecture us, what we have done in this budget. And I think people understand that.
Yes.
People know that. People can see now.
Yeah.
People can see the fakery that they were fed with before we came into government.
Right.
And what we are doing, Felix, is we are very transparent, open about what we wanted to do before the budget. There was no hiding of the fiscal review committee. Put out a very clear picture of expenditure, revenue, what was happening. And when we came into government, we discovered, we have said, things like, $400 million, film rebate.
Right.
We're still getting bills, to us.
Right.
And so we inherited an economy which was in a terrible mess. And so I'm surprised that it'll take time for the opposition to understand that they are in opposition, that they were in government before and the mess they have left. So I understand, what he's going about, and all these malicious rumors and lies that's coming from elements from the opposition. And people now understand that they are all lies and fake.
You also mentioned that the government is more prudent in spending. FBC has just received a 40% cut. Will we see similar sort of events happen in other state-owned entities?
Yeah. So what we are doing, Felix, is we brought the higher salaries commission as well.
Right.
We are strengthening the national planning office within the ministry.
Right.
That was totally gutted. In fact, there was no evidence-based policy making in many ways. There was no planning, there was no monitoring, there was no evaluation.
Right.
A lot of the things didn't happen because nobody was following. So what we are doing as a government and as Ministry of Finance, we are strengthening the National Planning Office, monitoring and evaluation.
Right.
I'm having a meeting with all the permanent secretaries next week.
Right.
And part of that meeting would be to strategize how we would be able to monitor and ensure that what is allocated in the budget is implemented properly on a timely basis.
Right.
So that the measures that we've announced in the budget can be delivered.
Right.
Because it's no point announcing measures in the budget if it is not implemented and delivered in a timely manner.
Right.
And I think as a government, all our ministers understand this. We have a very good team, a very united team.
Right.
Everybody is on the ground,
right,
trying to ensure that we deliver. Of course, we always say this, that we will make mistakes.
Yes.
There will be things that will not be done right. But as Minister of Finance, I can assure the people of this country is that we will be very hard about spending.
Right.
We will be very hard about delivering.
Right.
We will be very hard about making sure that every dollar that we collect from our people, as government revenue, is put to good use.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask this question because it is out on social media. That on the one hand, government is saying going to be tightening up and prudent with spending, and they see the ministers going off on overseas trips. And it is a fact that it's out there. Everyone knows.
Mm.
So, people can't seem to understand why.
No, there are two ways to answer that, Felix. One, there are some necessary troubles that, you know, any government, any minister will do. But as you said, you know, we could cut some of those down.
Yes.
The Prime Minister, of course, you know, provides that leadership.
Yes.
I think every minister in government understands the meaning of these travels.
Right.
There are some trips that require ministers to go,
right,
to be represented at the highest level.
Right.
There are benefits that come from these trips, you know, in terms of negotiation, in terms of understanding.
Right.
I mean, as I said, you know, we are part of the global village.
Right.
We're linked, you know, to the world,
right,
you know, in terms of, you know, our economy, our strategic interest. So there is an element of travel that is involved, but we as a government, we have to be mindful,
yes,
that it is prudent, that it is not excessive.
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll be right back after a short break.
Yeah.
Welcome back to The Lens 177. I'm having a discussion with the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister for Finance, Professor Biman Prasad. And we were just talking about ministers going on trips, and he mentioned that sometimes ministers do have to go, and it's probably good for the people to understand if it was communicated better to them, the need for the trips. So Deputy PM, there's also been some criticism on social media and even amongst various circles about hangers-on from the previous government, still holding positions in the coalition government, and some even in your ministry as well. You know, how do you respond to that?
No, I think some of those criticisms may be overboard. My view is that I consider civil servants to be neutral people, politically neutral.
Right.
So, you know, government changes, you know, they stay on. I mean, this used to be the culture. Of course, under the previous regime and the military regime, things had changed. You know, people had to be politically aligned to be able to survive in their jobs and all that. So some of those, you know, we understand. I don't, as a government, you know, we said this very clearly that we are not a government that is going to be vindictive,
right,
that is going to just come and, you know, remove people for the sake of removing them.
Right.
Yes, you know, there were people that that have been removed, you know, from boards and you know, from positions, because, you know, they were not you know, following the conventions and the protocols, and they were involved in you know, in some cases unlawful activities, and in some cases, you know, unethical behavior. So all that is being dealt with through proper processes.
Right.
We want to ensure that we don't behave like the previous government.
Yes.
You know, by being vindictive,
right,
just because, you know, somebody was associated with somebody else,
yes,
that we didn't like, or was, you know, part of another political party. Now, that is, for me, that is not going to be the only measure,
right,
of making sure that, you know, people stay or they don't stay. That's not my job. My job is to look at the performance, of the individuals. I can tell you, I mean, there's a fantastic group of people within this ministry, you know, starting from the permanent secretary, and I've seen that in the last 6 months. Now, I have no complaints about, you know, some of these civil servants. And civil servants must behave like that. You know, today we are in government, tomorrow we will not be there. But we expect the civil servants to continue and do the job in an apolitical manner, in an efficient and effective way. So I think we have to take out the civil servants from the other appointments like board members and all that. Yes, some people are still there, you know, who served in the previous regime, and some of them, no doubt, you know, were very good people, you know, meant well, you know, worked hard. Some of them are still there. Some have voluntarily chosen to, you know, step aside, you know, because they probably feel that, you know, they don't need to be there. And that's how this government has handled the situation, you know, of people who were identified politically. I mean, there are people who I know were openly politically aligned with the previous regime, the party. Some of them were donors and funders. Now, we as a government, you know, we take a very considered view of uniting the people, you know, not just witch hunt on the basis of your political affiliation or your social affiliation, which is what the previous government did. I mean, you know, they deported people because they were identifying themselves with the opposition political figures. You know, we talk to the opposition. I invite the opposition members of parliament into my office. If they want to discuss, you know, they come here. And I've had, you know, several of them talk to me. So we as a government, you know, we don't want to be vindictive, and we don't want to go on a witch hunt. If people have broken the law will take its course. The process will take its course, because we believe in the process. As Minister of Finance, as a politician, as a minister in government, you know, we have to set an example. So, you know, I mean, I can understand, because I can understand the feeling of the people, you know, because some of those people, some of them, you know, there are some who remain. Were politically aligned. You know, very strongly. But, you know, I think within a matter of time, and understanding and discussion, these things can be dealt with in a civil, professional, and an effective way.
You mentioned the Fiscal Review Committee's role quite significantly in our previous discussion. And you know, the recommendations they made, the ability to maybe monitor how government spends money. Would the Fiscal Review Committee be? Can we still see the committee remaining in place for some time or into the future?
I will be. First of all, let me thank the committee, thank the chairman, Mr. Richard Naidu, and all those members of the Fiscal Review Committee who gave up so much time. You know, these are people who want good for the country, who volunteered, who spent a lot of time. You know, spent hours. Producing, you know, such a good report. You know, we don't necessarily agree with every recommendation they made, but the fact that they spend so much time, so much energy to help the government, you know, to produce a report, you know, for the people, you know, it shows that there's so much goodwill for this government. Personally, I mean, I will be meeting them soon. Right. I want the committee to continue.
Okay.
Obviously, we had the National Economic Summit. We had thematic working groups. Which identified, you know, areas where, you know, we need to improve, do things.
Right.
We want to activate those groups. Our National Planning Office would provide support. We are working out the mechanics through which we are going to do, because what it will do, Felix, is it will create a direct, you know, communication, a line of thinking, discussion, you know, appreciation of ideas, and it can only be good for us as Ministry of Finance, but also good for the government.
Right.
So we are going to spend some resources to ensure that we keep the dialogue, we give some formal structure.
Right.
To these dialogue and consultation and discussion.
Right.
And so, yes, you know, I plan to keep the committee.
Right.
I plan to operationalize, you know, how they can, you know, be there,
right.
But also, you know, work with the government, you know, nudge, you know, us on policies,
right.
And measures that we have put in the budget, because all that will help into the delivery and the effectiveness,
right.
Of our implementation strategy.
Okay, thank you. One issue that has been highlighted by some members of the business community is the Immigration Act being very outdated. So, for example, an investor can come in with, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars, but to get Fiji citizenship or a passport takes 15 years.
Yeah.
You know.
That was a stupid law. I could never figure out the logic. Nobody in our government can actually figure that out.
Right.
As a government, you know, the Honorable Prime Minister has already asked for a review of the. I can tell you this. As a government, led by the Honorable Prime Minister, has already indicated that the whole immigration law would be reviewed,
right.
Including the citizenship. I mean, no country in the world that I know requires you to go and live there for 15 years. I mean, if we want good investors, if we want people,
yes.
to come, behind investment, behind money are people, are families.
Yes.
You know, people want to come to Fiji, invest, live here, make Fiji their home.
Yes.
And we are asking them to stay here for 15 years,
right.
Under some, you know, work permit or business permit arrangement, right. Until they get this. I mean, it's nuts. It just doesn't make sense.
Yes.
So all that will be reviewed. Our immigration department is working very hard. We've allocated additional funding,
okay.
To the department to have more staff, and we expect a lot more efficiency from the immigration department while we review the laws, and that will be done as soon as possible. I can confirm that.
Thank you. Interesting discussion, and we'll be right back after a short break.
Yeah.
We were around when the deed was first signed. We were around when the first car engine roared. We were around when the very first was crowned. Through devastations, jubilant celebrations, and the milestones, we will continue to be around to bring you all the stories first.
Welcome back to The Lens at 177, and you know, the conversation over the Immigration Act with the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister for Finance, Professor Biman Prasad, is just heating up. Professor Prasad, changes to the Immigration Act, what else can you tell us?
Yeah, I mean, from an economic point of view, from the point of view of, you know, shortage of skills, you know, our need for, you know, more investment. As I said before, behind investment, behind economic prosperity is movement of people. I mean, you know, most countries in the world do that. So, as I said, you know, the 15-year requirement was nuts, stupid law that will have to be changed. Recently, the government changed the Immigration Act, which was very specific about the Bola Nikam Bula. But as a government, the changes will include everybody, not just those in the Bola Nikam Bula, descendants of former Fiji citizens. If they are out there, if they don't have a Fiji passport, they can come without a permit, leave, you know, and enter Fiji without having to have a permit.
Right.
So, you know, that's also good for our diaspora. You know, we want them to come, and in fact, a lot of them want to come back to Fiji, and there's been a lot of confidence in the last 6 months. Not only just people wanting to come back and live here, but also there are a lot of people, you know, our people, you know, who left have done well, have got acquired skills, you know, expertise, and have a lot of, you know, funding to invest. Those are the kind of people we want here. And we welcome them, and so all these changes to the immigration laws and making it easier for investment approvals and all that is going to help us, you know, attract more investment, and that's what we want to do. So, you know, I also want to take this opportunity, Felix, to thank all our people, our diaspora, you know. I mean, they're sending millions of dollars this year. We expect, you know, more than probably $1.2-1.3 billion in remittances. But apart from remittances, you know, there's so much goodwill, there's so much thinking about, you know, Fiji, you know, from our former Fiji citizens, and I want to thank all of them. We are trying to make things as easy as possible for all those who want to return to Fiji, invest in Fiji, live in Fiji, and that's the objective of the changes that has been done, and those that will be done pretty soon that will include non-former Fiji citizens, investors, people who want to come and invest, live, and be part of Fiji. We are going to work towards that, so that, you know, and I think for the for the future of this country, we need to do that urgently.
Still on immigration, another discussion that we have received information on is one impediment in filling skills gaps for companies in Fiji, because we're losing a lot of technical staff to Australia, New Zealand, etc. Is trying to bring technical staff and people from abroad here. You know, because of the Immigration Act, it's quite difficult. Will that change?
Well, all that is part of the package of reforms that we are trying to undertake, and will be done as soon as possible, as I have said, to make sure that, you know, we are much more efficient, effective, you know, within the appropriate law, within the appropriate checks and balances, to ensure, you know, we don't want, you know, permit to be sitting in the Immigration Department for 6 months. We need to be more efficient as a government to be able to facilitate this. So all that is under review.
You know, for the low-income earner and the poor, when they go to the supermarket shelf and they see how prices of food has, you know, gone up so much in the last couple of years, seven companies control food prices on our shelves, seven. We've seen shipping costs and other related costs come down to pre-COVID levels, but we don't see the same the reduction reflected in the price of goods. Is that something government is looking at?
We are mindful of some of those views. There is some truth in some areas. Some are exaggerated, but what we're trying to do, Felix, in this budget is to ensure that we, from the government side, you know, we are doing the right thing. We've maintained the 21 basic, you know, food items to remain zero rated. In terms of VET, we've added, you know, prescribed medicine, so it's 22 items. We've reduced duty on certain food items, including, you know, meat, you know, yes. Includes chicken and other, you know, lamb and beef, because we feel that, you know, there should be some direct relief to the consumers, you know, in terms of the prices.
Right.
But you're right, we expect, you know, the food importers,
yes.
Supermarkets, everyone to play their part, you know, because it's also beneficial to their business,
yes.
Because sometimes, you know, reducing the price doesn't necessarily mean, you know, a loss in, you know, profits.
Right.
You know, the volume can compensate, you know, the reduced price. So it makes sense. And what we are expecting, so, you know, we expect FCCC to, you know, do its job,
yes.
Make sure that, you know, the prices, the policy, intervention by the government,
yes.
Results in, you know, the price,
yes.
That is charged, you know, out there in the supermarkets and in shops.
Right.
So it's always a difficult one. It's always a hard one. There are some, you know, unscrupulous, you know, businesses who do that, but by and large, you know, majority of them, you know, follow the law, and we expect, and I would like to believe that a lot of them would like to support, you know, government's effort to control.
Yes.
Or provide some relief to the consumers. We expect the freight cost has been coming down.
Yes.
So we expect that to be reflected in the final, you know, price of products in the supermarkets. Of course, you know, we have other taxes there.
Yes.
But generally, we feel that a large section of our business community are responsible people.
Right.
They do honest days of work. They work hard. They create, you know, our economy. They create jobs.
Right.
And so we would like to believe and work with them.
Right.
Wherever we feel that there are things that are not happening, that we would like to work with them and make sure that they do the right things.
And just lastly, if you could speak to the people, you know, I think the uncertainty is gone with the budget now out.
Mm.
You know, can you just tell the people what does the future hold?
Well, all I want to say to the people that in this budget, we have allocated enough funding for social welfare. We've increased social welfare allowances by 25%,
right.
25% for those, you know, who are over the age of 70. All different programs within the social welfare ministry has been increased by 15%.
Right.
Government pensioners have received a 15% increase. We've included some FNPF pensioners, you know, who were hard done by the previous government, where, you know, unilaterally, you know, the pension rate was reduced and many of them suffered. So we've added additional, you know, $125 or $115 to the pension that they get, and that would be appreciated.
Right.
We have allocated enough money for to fix water, roads, infrastructure, health.
Right.
The biggest thing we've done is to write off the tails debt, which was not being paid anyway. We've lifted the burden on more than 53,000. You know, families and their children, and we created a scholarship scheme, you know, which is not only going to deal with the shortage of skills in key areas, improvement, manpower resource planning. So what I want to say to the people is we need your support. We need a little bit of patience.
Right.
I know, I sympathize, you know, and we apologize to our people, you know, in terms of water cuts.
Right.
You know, I've had water cuts in my home, and I understand how difficult it can be.
Right.
With families, with older people, with children, when you wake up in the morning and there is no water in the taps.
Yes.
So we sympathize with the people. These are some legacy issues. We are investing enough, and we are determined to fix some of these problems. But we can't do this, tomorrow.
Yes.
It will take some time, but the work has already begun. In different areas. So, and we want to, and I also want to thank the people, for understanding. And we're actually quite excited. I'm quite excited by the feedback that I'm getting.
Right.
The level of understanding that people have, ordinary people,
yes,
about, where we are as a government, what needs to be done. And most people in this country, want good for everyone,
yes,
for the country. There is no room for a malicious agenda.
Right.
There is no room for fake, and malicious, propaganda.
Right.
I think the time for that kind of fakery,
yes,
that kind of, electioneering, popularism,
right,
fear is over.
Right.
I think people feel free. They understand the situation and they're prepared to work with the government in taking the country forward, and I want to thank everyone for that.
There you go, folks. You heard it from the man himself, our money man,
okay,
our Deputy Prime Minister, Professor Biman Prasad. Please remember to visit our website, www.fijitimes.com, to see this interview and to read about it in the Fiji Times. And also visit our Facebook page, Twitter and Instagram.
Thank you.
Thank you.